Lay Down Your Arms, The Autobiography of Martha von Tilling by Bertha von Suttner, translated by Timothy Holmes, Monument, Colorado. Lay Down Your Arms, Two Prefaces of the Translator. Translator's Preface to the First Edition. When I was requested by the Committee of the International Arbitration and Peace Association, of which I have the honor to be a member, to undertake the translation of the novel entitled Die Waffen Nieder, I considered it my duty to consent, and I have found the labor truly a delight. Baroness Suttner's striking tale has had so great a success on the continent of Europe that it seems singular that no complete translation into English should yet have appeared. An incomplete version was published some time since in the United States without the sanction of the authoress, but it gives no just idea of the work. Apart from its value as a work of fiction, great as that is, the book has a transcendent interest for the society with which I am connected, from its bearing on the question of war in general and of the present state of Europe in particular. We English-speaking people, whether in England, in the colonies, or in the United States, being ourselves in no immediate danger of seeing our homes invaded and our cities laid under contribution by hostile armies, are apt to forget how terribly the remembrance of such calamities and the constant threat of their recurrence haunt the lives of our continental brethren. Madam Suttner's vivid pages will enable those of us who have not seen anything of the ravages of war or felt the griefs and anxieties of non-combatants to realize the state in which people live on the continent of Europe under the grim shadow of the sword, with constantly increasing demands on the treasure accumulated by their labor, and on their still dearer treasure, their children, drawn into the ravenous maw of the conscription, to meet the ever-increasing demands of war, which seems daily drawing nearer and nearer, in spite of the protestations made by every government of its anxiety for peace. What can we expect to change this terrible condition, except the formation of a healthy public opinion? And what can more powerfully contribute to its formation than a clear conception both of the horrors and sufferings that have attended the great wars waged in our times, and also of the inadequacy of the reasons, at least the ostensible reasons, for their commencement, and the ease with which they might have been avoided if their reasons had been indeed their causes? This work appears to me of especial value, as setting this forth more plainly than a formal treatise could do, and it is towards the formation of such a public opinion that we hope it may contribute. The dawn of a better day in respect of war is plain enough in our country. We have advanced far indeed from the state of things that existed a century ago, when Coleridge could indignantly say of England, "Mid thy herds and thy cornfields secure, thou hast stood, and joined the wild yelling of famine and blood." England since then has given and is giving many gratifying proofs of her sincere desire for peace, and her readiness to submit her claims to peaceful arbitration. Is it too much to hope that we may see our country joining in some well-considered scheme for general treaties of arbitration and for the institution of an international court? And may we not hope that our influence, as that of a nation not implicated in the mad race of armaments, and yet not removed from the area of European war, may avail to bring the question of disarmament before an international conference, and thus introduce the 20th century into a world in which there will be some brighter prospect than that war shall endless war still breed. Let us trust that this may not be found quite an idle dream, and that we may without self-delusion look forward to a more happy era, and join the cry of Baroness Suttner's Rudolph, Es liebe die Zukunft, Hail to the Future. Preface to the Second Edition. The rapid sale of the first edition of this translation has encouraged the association at whose request it was made to endeavor to make it more widely known to the various English-speaking populations by printing a larger edition at a lower price. It is hoped, also, that the enlarged circulation of a work so graphic and written by one who has so thoroughly studied the real aspects of war, as seen by those on the spot, may lead not so much to sentimental emotions and vague protests, as to a businesslike discussion of the means by which the resort to war may be at any rate rendered more and more infrequent. The English government has lately given repeated and practical proofs of its sincere desire to substitute the peaceful and rational method of arbitration for the rough, cruel, and uncertain decision of force, and the conspicuous success of that method hitherto, though tried under circumstances not altogether favorable, must have prepared thinking men for the question, why cannot some scheme for the formation of an international tribunal of arbitration be formed and debated among the powers who, by taking part in the Congress at Paris after the Crimean War, formally admitted the principle, and who have already seen it successfully applied in practice? To this question, which has frequently been asked, no satisfactory answer has yet been given, nor to the further question why our government should not introduce the subject to the great powers, after showing so unmistakably its adherence to the principle. People differ, and probably will always differ, as to the light in which they regard war. A very small and rapidly diminishing minority regard it as a good thing in itself. Most as an evil which in our present state of civilization cannot always be avoided. Some as a crime formally prohibited by the moral law and the Christian religion. All of the two latter classes ought to join in any practical steps for diminishing the occasions of war. And of these, the one which is most within the scope of politicians is the promotion of international arbitration. The association to which I belong has published this work in the confident hope that its circulation will aid in hastening this much-needed reform. The Translator. End of two prefaces of The Translator. Section 1 of Lay Down Your Arms, Monument, Colorado. Lay Down Your Arms by Bertha von Suttner, translated by Timothy Holmes. Chapter 1. At 17, I was a thoroughly overwrought creature. This perhaps I should no longer be aware of today, if it were not that my diaries have been preserved. But in them, the enthusiasms long since fled, the thoughts which have never been thought again, the feelings never again felt, have immortalized themselves, and thus I can judge at this present time what exalted notions had stuck in my silly, pretty head. Even this prettiness, of which my glass has now little left to say, is revealed to me by the portraits of long ago. I can figure to myself what an envied person the Countess Martha Althaus, youthful, thought beautiful, and surrounded by all kinds of luxury, must have been. These remarkable diaries, however, bound in their red covers, point more to melancholy than to joy in life. The question I now ask myself is, was I really so silly as not to recognize the advantages of my position, or was I only so enthusiastic as to believe that only melancholy feelings were elevated and worthy of being expressed in poetical form, and as such enrolled in the red volumes? My lot seems not to have contented me, for thus it is written, O Joan of Arc, heroic virgin, favored of heaven, could I be like thee, to wave the oriflamme, to crown my king, and then die for the fatherland, the beloved. No opportunity offered itself to me of realizing these modest views of life. Again, to be torn to pieces in the circus by a lion as a Christian martyr, another vocation for which I longed, see entry of September 19, 1853, was not to be compassed by me, and so I had plainly to suffer under the consciousness that the great deeds after which my soul thirsted must remain ever unaccomplished, that my life, considered fundamentally, was a failure. Ah, why had I not come into the world as a boy? Another fruitless reproach against destiny, which often found expression in the red volumes. In that case, I would have been able to strive after and to achieve the exalted. Of female heroism, history affords but few examples. How seldom do we succeed in having the Gracchi for our sons, or in carrying our husbands out to the Weisberg gates, or in being saluted by saber-brandishing Magyars with the shout, Hurrah for Maria Theresa, our king! But when one is a man, then one need only gird on the sword and start off to win fame and laurels. win for oneself a throne like Cromwell, or the empire of the world like Bonaparte. I recollect that the highest conception of human greatness seemed to me to be embodied in warlike heroism. For scholars, poets, explorers, I had indeed a sort of respect, but only the winners of battles inspired me with real admiration. These were indeed the chief pillars of history, the rulers of the fate of countries. These were in importance and in elevation near to the divinity, as elevated above all other folk as the peaks of the Alps and Himalayas above the turf and flowers of the valley. From all which I need not conclude that I possessed a heroic nature. The fact was, simply, that I was capable of enthusiasm and impassioned, and so I was, of course, passionately enthusiastic for that which was most highly accounted of by my schoolbooks and my entourage. My father was a general in the Austrian army, and had fought at Custoza under Father Radetzky, whom he venerated to superstition. What eternal campaigning stories had I to listen to! Dear Papa was so proud of his warlike experiences, and spoke with such satisfaction of the campaigns in which he had fought, that I felt an involuntary pity for every man who possessed no such reminiscences. But what a drawback for the female sex to be excluded from this most magnificent display of the manly feeling of honor and duty! If anything came to my ears about the efforts of women after equality, and of this in my youth but little was heard, and then usually in a tone of contempt and condemnation, I conceived the wish for emancipation only in one direction, viz., that women also should have the right to carry arms and take the field. Ah, how beautiful was it to read in history about a Semiramis or a Catherine too! She carried on war with this or that neighboring state. She conquered this or that country. Speaking generally, it is history which, as our youth are instructed, is the chief source of the admiration of war. From thence it is stamped on the childish mind that the Lord of Armies is constantly decreeing battles, that these are, as it were, the vehicle upon which the destiny of nations is carried on through the ages, that they are the fulfillment of an inevitable law of nature and must always occur from time to time, like storms at sea or earthquakes, that terror and woe are indeed connected with them, but the latter is fully counterpoised, for the commonwealth by the importance of the results, for individuals by the blaze of glory which may be won in them, or even by the consciousness of the fulfillment of the most elevated duty. Can there be a more glorious death than that on the field of honor, a nobler immortality than that of the hero? All this comes out clear and unanimous in all schoolbooks of Readings for the Use of Schools, where, besides the formal history, which is only represented as a concatenation of military events, even the separate tales and poems always manage to tell only of heroic deeds of arms. This is a part of the patriotic system of education. Since out of every scholar a defender of his country has to be formed, therefore the enthusiasm even of the child must be aroused for this its first duty as a citizen. His spirit must be hardened against the natural horror which the terrors of war might awaken, by passing over as quickly as possible the story of the most fearful massacres and butcheries as of something quite common and necessary, and laying meanwhile all possible stress on the ideal side of this ancient national custom. And it is in this way they have succeeded in forming a race eager for battle and delighting in war. The girls, who indeed are not to take the field, are educated out of the same books as are prepared for the military training of the boys, and so in the female youth arises the same conception which exhausts itself in envy that they have nothing to do with war, and in admiration for the military class. What pictures of horror out of all the battles on earth, from the Biblical and Macedonian and Punic wars, down to the 30 Years' War and the wars of Napoleon, were brought before us tender maidens, who in all other things were formed to be gentle and mild. How we saw their cities burnt, and the inhabitants put to the sword, and the conquered trodden down, and all this was a real enjoyment. And of course, through this heaping up and repetition of the horrors, the perception that they were horrors becomes blunted. Everything which belongs to the category of war comes no longer to be regarded from the point of view of humanity, and receives a perfectly peculiar mystico-historico-political consecration. War must be, it is the source of the highest dignities and honors, That the girls see very well, and they have had also to learn by heart the poems and tirades in which war is magnified, and thus originate the Spartan mothers, and the mothers of the colors, and the frequent invitations to the cotillion which are given to the corps of officers when it is the turn of the ladies to choose partners. I was not like so many of my companions in rank educated in a convent, but under the direction of governesses and masters in my father's house. My mother I lost early. Our aunt, an old canoness, filled the place of a mother to us children, for there were three younger children. We spent the winter months in Vienna, the summer on a family estate in Lower Austria. I can remember that I gave my governesses and masters much satisfaction, for I was an industrious and ambitious scholar, gifted with an accurate memory. When I could not, as I have remarked, satisfy my ambition by winning battles like a heroine, I contented myself with passing judgments on them in my lessons, and extorting admiration by my zeal for learning. In the French and English languages I was nearly perfect. In geology and astronomy I made as much progress as was ordinarily accessible in the program of the education of a girl. But in the subject of history I learned more than was required of me. Out of the library of my father I fetched the ponderous works of history, in which I studied in my leisure hours. I always thought myself a little bit cleverer when I could enrich my memory with an event, a name, or a date out of past times. Against pianoforte playing, which was put down in the plan of education, I made a resolute resistance. I possessed neither talent nor desire for music, and felt that in it, for me, no satisfaction of my ambition would be found. I begged so long and so pressingly that my precious time, which I might spend on my other studies, should not be shortened by this meaningless strumming, that my good father let me off this musical servitude, to the great grief of my aunt, whose opinion was that without pianoforte playing there could be no proper education. On March 10, 1857, I celebrated my 17th birthday. 17 already! Runs the entry of that date in my diary. This already is in itself a poem. There is no commentary added, but probably I meant by it, and as yet nothing done for immortality. These red volumes do me excellent service now, when I want to recall the recollections of a life. They render it possible for me to depict, even down to their minutest details, the feelings of the past, which would have remained in my memory only as faded outlines, and to reproduce whole trains of thought long forgotten, and long silent speeches. In the following carnival I was to be brought out. This prospect delighted me, but not to such an extraordinary degree as is usually the case with young girls. My spirit yearned for something higher than the triumphs of the ballroom. What was it I yearned for? A question that I could have hardly answered to myself. Probably for love, though I was not aware of it. All those glowing dreams of aspiration and ambition which swell the hearts of young men and women, and which long to work themselves out all sorts of ways, as thirst for knowledge, love of travel or adventure, are in reality, for the most part, only the unrecognized activity of the growing instinct of love. This summer my aunt was ordered a course of the waters at Marienbad. She was pleased to take me with her. Though my official introduction into the so-called world was not to take place till the following winter, I was yet allowed to take part in some little dances at the Kurhaus, with an idea also of exercising me in dancing and conversation, so that I might not be altogether too shy and awkward in entering on my first carnival season. But what happened at the first party which I visited? A serious, vital love affair. It was, of course, a lieutenant of hussars. The civilians in the hall appeared to me like cockchafers to butterflies compared to the soldiers, and of the wearers of uniforms present, the hussars were every way the most splendid, and finally, of all the hussars, Count Arno Dotsky was the most dazzling. Over 6 feet high, with black curly hair, twisted mustaches, glittering white teeth, dark eyes, with such a penetrating and tender expression. In fine, at his question, "Have you the cotillion free, Countess?" I felt that there might be other triumphs as exciting as the banner-waving of the Maid of Orleans, or the scepter-waving of the great Catherine, and he, at the age of 22, felt something very similar as he flew around the room in the waltz with the prettiest girl in the hall, for one may say so 30 years afterwards. At any rate, he was probably thinking, "To possess thee, thou sweet creature, would outweigh a field marshal's baton." "Why, Martha, Martha!" remonstrated my aunt, as I sank breathless on the seat at her side, covering her headdress with the floating muslins of my robe. "Oh, I beg your pardon, auntie," said I, and sat more upright. "I could not help it." "I was not finding fault with you for that. My blame was for your behavior with that hussar. You ought not to cling so in dancing, and who would ever look so close into a gentleman's eyes?" I blushed deep. Had I committed some unmaidenly offense, and might the incomparable have conceived a bad idea of me? I was relieved of this anxious doubt before the ball was over, for in the course of the supper waltz, the incomparable whispered to me, "Listen to me. I cannot help it. You must know it even today. I love you." This sounded a little more sweet than Joan's famous voices. However, while the dance was going on, I could not give him any reply. He must have seen this, for he came to a stop. We were standing in an empty corner of the room and could continue the conversation without being overheard.
"Speak, Countess. What have I to hope?"
"I do not understand you," was my insincere reply.
"Perhaps you do not believe in love at first sight. I myself held it a fable till now, but today I have experienced the truth of it."
How my heart beat, but I was silent.
"I have leapt head over heels into my fate," he continued. "You or no one. Decide then for my bliss or my death, for without you I neither can nor will live. Will you be mine?"
To so direct a question, I was obliged to give some reply. I sought for some extremely diplomatic phrase, which, without cutting off all hope, would sacrifice nothing of my dignity. But I got out nothing more than a tremulous whispered, "Yes."
"Then may I tomorrow propose for your hand to your aunt and write to Count Althaus?"
"Yes." Again, this time a little firmer.
"Oh, what happiness! So at first sight, you love me too?"
This time I only answered with my eyes, but they, I fancy, spoke the plainest. "Yes." End of chapter 1, part 1. Section 2 of Lay Down Your Arms, Monument, Colorado. Lay Down Your Arms, by Bertha von Suttner, translated by Timothy Holmes. Chapter 1, Part 2. On my 18th birthday, I was married, after having been first introduced into society and presented to the Empress on my engagement. After our wedding, we went for a tour in Italy. For this purpose, Arno had got a long leave of absence. Of retirement from the military service, nothing was ever said. It is true, we both possessed a tolerable property, but my husband loved his profession, and I agreed with him. I was proud of my handsome hussar officer, and looked forward with satisfaction to the time when he would rise to the rank of major, colonel, even general. Who knows, perhaps he might even be called to a higher fortune. Perhaps he might shine in the glorious history of his country as a great military commander. That the red volumes exhibit a break just during the happy wedding time and the honeymoon is now to me a great grief. The joys of those days would indeed have been evaporated, dispersed, scattered to the winds, even if I had entered them there, but at any rate a reflection of them would have been kept bound tight between the leaves. But no, for my grief and my pain I could not find complaints enough dashes and notes of exclamation. All grievous things had to be cried over carefully before the world, present and to come, but the happy hours I enjoyed in silence. I was not proud of my happiness, and so gave no one, not even myself, in my diary, any information about it, but sufferings and longings I looked on as a kind of merit, and so made much of them. But how true a mirror these red volumes present of my sad experiences, while in the happy times the leaves are quite blank. It is too silly. It is as if during a walk a man were to make a collection to bring home with him, and to collect of all the things he found by the way, only those that were ugly, as if he filled his botanic case with nothing but thorns, thistles, worms, and toads, and left the flowers and butterflies behind. Still, I recollect that it was a grand time, a kind of fairy dream. I had indeed everything that the heart of a young woman could wish, love, wealth, rank, fortune, and most of it so new, so surprising, so incredible. We loved each other, my Arno and I, devotedly, with all the fire of our youth, abounding as it was in life and scenes of beauty. And it so happened that my darling hussar was besides a worthy, good-hearted, noble-minded young gentleman, with the education of a man of the world, and a cheerful temper. It happened so, for he might as well, for anything that the ball at Marienbad could testify to the contrary, have been a vicious, rough man. And as it happened also, I was a moderately sensible, good-hearted creature, for he might just as well, at the said ball, have fallen in love with a pretty, capricious little goose. And so it came about that we were completely happy, and that, as a consequence, the red-bound book of lamentation remained empty for a long while. Stop! Here I do find a joyous entry. Raptures over the new dignity of motherhood. On the 1st of January, 1859, was not that a New Year's gift? A little son was born to us. Of course this event awakened in us as much astonishment and pride as if we were the first pair to which anything of the kind had happened. And this accounts also for the resumption of the diary. Of this wonder and of this dignity of mine, the world of the future had to be informed. Besides, the theme, youthful motherhood, is so extremely well adapted for art and literature. It belongs to the class of the best sung and most carefully painted subjects. Besides, it may be treated mystically and sacredly, touchingly and pathetically, simply and affectionately, in short, immensely poetically. To nurse this disposition, all possible collections of poems, illustrated journals, picture galleries, and current phrases of rapture, such as mother's love, mother's happiness, mother's pride, contribute their power, just as the school books do to nurse the admiration for war. The highest pitch of deification which has ever been reached next to the adoration of heroes, see Carlyle's hero worship, is reached by the multitude in baby worship. And of course in this also I was not left behind. My little charming Ruru was to me the mightiest wonder of the world. Ah, my son, my grown-up stately Rudolph, what I feel for you is such that against it that childish baby wonder loses color. Against it, that blind, apish, devouring love of the young mother is as insignificant as the child himself in swaddling clothes is insignificant by the side of the grown man. The young father was not less proud of his successor, and built on him the fairest schemes for the future. What will he be? This question, not as yet a very pressing one, was nevertheless often discussed over Ruru's cradle, and always decided unanimously, a soldier. Sometimes it awoke a weak protest on the mother's part. But suppose he should meet with any accident in a war? Ah, bah, was the answer to this objection. Everyone must die when and where it is appointed him. Ruru was also not to remain the only son. Of the following sons, one might, please God, be brought up as a diplomatist, another as a country gentleman, a third as a priest. But the eldest... he must choose his father's and grandfather's profession, the noblest profession of all. He must be a soldier. And so it was settled. Ruru, as soon as he was 2 months old, was promoted by us to be lance corporal. Well, as all crown princes immediately they are born are named proprietors of some regiment, why should not we also decorate our little one with an imaginary rank? It was only a regular joke, this playing at soldiers with our baby. On April 1, as the third monthly recurrence of his birthday, for to keep only the anniversaries would have given too few opportunities for festivity, Ruru was promoted from lance corporal to corporal. But on the same day there happened also something more mournful, something that made my heart heavy and obliged me to relieve it into the red volumes. There had been now for a long time a certain black point visible on the political horizon, about the possible increase of which the liveliest commentaries were made in all journals and at all private parties. I had up to that time thought nothing about it. My husband and my father and their military friends might have often said in my hearing, "There will soon be something to settle with Italy."
but it glanced off my understanding. I had little time or inclination to trouble myself about politics, so that, however eagerly people about me might debate about the relations between Sardinia and Austria, or the behavior of Napoleon III, of whose help Cavour had assured himself by taking part in the Crimean War, or however constantly they might talk about the tension which this alliance had called forth between us and our Italian neighbors, I took no notice of it. But on April 1, my husband said to me very seriously, "Do you know, dear, that it will soon break out?" "What will break out, darling?" "The war with Sardinia." I was terrified.
"My God, that would be terrible. And will you have to go?"
"I hope so."
"How can you say such a thing? Hope to leave your wife and child?"
"If duty calls."
"One might reconcile oneself to it, but to hope, which means wish, that such a bitter duty should arise."
"Bitter? A rattling jolly war like that must be something glorious. You are a soldier's wife. Don't forget that."
I fell on his neck.
"Oh, my dear husband, be content. I also can be brave. How often have I sympathized with the heroes and heroines of history? What an elevating feeling it must be to go into battle. If I only might fight, fall, or conquer at your side."
"Bravely spoken, little wife, but nonsense. Your place is here, by the cradle of the little one, who also is to become a defender of his country when he is grown up. Your place is at our household hearth. It is to protect this and guard it from any hostile attack, to preserve peace for our homes and our wives, that we men have to go to battle."
I don't know why, but these words, which, or something of the same sort, I had often before heard and read with assent, this time seemed to me to be in a sense mere phrases. There was certainly no hearth menaced, no horde of barbarians at the gate, merely a political tension between two cabinets. So if my husband was all on fire to rush into the war, it was not so much from the pressing need of defending his wife, child, and country, but rather his delight in the march out, which promised change and adventure, his seeking for distinction and promotion. "Oh, yes," was my conclusion from this train of thought. "It is ambition, a noble, honorable ambition, delight in the brave discharge of duty." It was good of him that he was rejoicing in the chance of being obliged to take the field, for as yet there was assuredly no certainty. Perhaps the war might not break out at all, and even in case they came to blows, who knows whether it would be Arno's fate to be sent off. The whole army does not always see the enemy. No, this splendid, perfect happiness which fate had just built as a snug house for me, it was impossible that the same fate should roughly shatter it to pieces.
"Oh, Arno, my dearly loved husband, it would be horrible to know that you are in danger."
These and similar outpourings fill the leaves of the diary which were written in those days. From this period, the red volumes are full for some time of political stuff. Louis Napoleon is an intriguer. Austria cannot long be only a spectator. It is coming to war. Sardinia will be frightened at our superior power and give in. Peace is going to be maintained. My wishes, despite of all theoretical admiration of the battles of the past, were of course secretly directed to the preservation of peace, but the wish of my spouse called openly for the other alternative. He did not say anything out plainly, but he always communicated any news about the increase of the black spot with sparkling eyes, while, on the contrary, he always took note of such peaceful prospects as occurred now and then, but alas, they became always rarer, with a kind of dejection. My father also was all on fire for the war. To conquer the Piedmontese would be only child's play, and, in support of this assertion, the Radetzky anecdotes were poured out again. I heard the impending campaign talked about always from the strategic point of view, in other words, a balancing of the chances on the two sides, how and where the enemy would be routed, and the advantages which would thereby accrue to us. The humane point of view, namely, that whether lost or won, every battle demands innumerable sacrifices of blood and tears, was quite left out of sight. The interests which were here in question were represented as raised to such a height above any private destiny that I felt ashamed of the meanness of my way of thinking if at times the thought occurred to me, "Ah, what joy do the poor slain men, the poor cripples, the poor widows get out of the victory. However, very soon the old schoolbook dithyrams came in again for an answer to all these despairing questionings. Glory offers recompense for all. Still, suppose the enemy wins? This question I propounded in the circle of my military friends, but was ignominiously hissed down. The mere mention of the possibility of a shadow of a doubt is in itself unpatriotic. To be certain beforehand of one's invincibility is a part of the soldier's duties, and therefore, in her degree, of those of a loyal wife of a lieutenant. My husband's regiment was quartered in Vienna. From our home, there was a view over the Prater, and from the window there was such a lovely promise of summer over everything. It was a wonderful spring. The air was warm and redolent of violets, and the fresh foliage sprouted out more early than in other years. I was amusing myself without any anxiety over the great processions in the Prater, which were planned for the following month. We had, for this purpose, procured a tasty little equipage, a brake with a four-in-hand team of Hungarian horses. Even already in this splendid April weather, we kept driving almost daily in the alleys of the Prater, but that was only a foretaste of the pleasure peculiar to May. Ah, if the war had not broken in on all that!
"Now, thank God, at last this uncertainty is at an end," cried my husband one morning, April 19, on coming home from parade. "The ultimatum has been sent."
I shrieked out, "Eh, what? What does that mean?"
"It means that the last word of the diplomatic formalities, the one which precedes the declaration of war, has been spoken. Our ultimatum to Sardinia calls on Sardinia to disarm. She, of course, will take no notice of it, and we march across the frontier."
"Good God! But perhaps they may disarm?"
"Well, then, the quarrel would be at an end, and peace would continue." I fell on my knees. I could not help it. Silently, but still as earnestly as if with a cry, there rose the prayer from my soul to heaven for peace, peace. Arno raised me up. "My silly child, what are you doing?"
I threw my arms round his neck and began to weep. It was no burst of pain, for the misfortune was certainly as yet not decided on, but the news had so shaken me that my nerves quivered, and that caused this flood of tears.
"Martha, Martha, you will make me angry,"
said Arno reproachfully.
"Is this being my brave little soldier's wife? Do you forget that you are a general's daughter, wife of a first lieutenant, and," he concluded with a smile, "mother of a corporal?"
"No, no, Arno, I do not comprehend myself. It was only a kind of seizure. I am really myself ardent for military glory, but I do not know how it is. A little while ago everything was hanging on a single word, which must by this time have been spoken, yes or no, in answer to this ultimatum, as it is called, and this yes or no is to decide whether thousands must bleed and die. Die in these sunny, happy days of spring. And so it came over me that the word of peace must come, and I could not help falling on my knees in prayer."
"To inform the Almighty of the position of affairs, you dear little goose."
The house bell rang. I dried my eyes at once. Who could it be so early? It was my father. He rushed in all in a hurry.
"Now, children," he cried, all out of breath, throwing himself into an armchair. "Have you heard the great news? The ultimatum. I have just told my wife."
"Tell me, dear papa, what you think," I asked anxiously. "Will that prevent the war?"
"I am not aware that an ultimatum ever prevented a war. It would indeed be only prudent of this wretched rabble of Italians to give in and not expose themselves to a second Novara. Ah, if good Father Radetzky had not died last year, I believe he would, in spite of his 90 years, have put himself again at the head of his army, and by God, I would have marched along with him. We too have, I think, shown already how to manage these foreign scum, but it seems they have not yet had enough of it, the puppies. They want a second lesson. All right, our Lombardo-Venetian kingdom will get a handsome addition in the Piedmontese territory, and I already look forward to the entry of our troops into Turin."
"But, Papa, you speak just as if war were already declared, and you were glad of it. But how if Arno has to go too?" And the tears were already in my eyes again.
"That he will too, the enviable young fellow."
"But my terror!
The danger... what? Danger? A man may fight and not be slain, as the saying goes. I have gone through more than one campaign, thank God, and been wounded more than once, and yet I am all alive, just because it was ordained that I should live through it.
The old fatalist way of talking, the same as prevailed to settle Ruru's choice of a profession, and which even now appeared to me again as quite philosophical.
Even if it should chance that my regiment is not ordered out, Arno began.
Oh, yes, I joyfully broke in. There is still that hope.
In that case, I would get exchanged if possible. Oh, it will be quite possible, my father assured him. Hess is to receive the command-in-chief, and he is a good friend of mine.
My heart trembled, and yet I could not help admiring both the men. With what a joyful equanimity they spoke of a coming campaign, as if it were only a question of some pleasure trip that had been arranged. My brave Arno was desirous, even if his duty did not summon him, to go and meet the foe, and my magnanimous father thought that quite simple and natural. I collected myself, away with childish, womanish fear. Now was the time to show myself worthy of this my love, to raise my heart above all egotistic fears, and find room for nothing but the noble reflection, my husband is a hero. I sprang up and stretched out both my hands to him.
Arno, I am proud of you.
He put my hands to his lips, then turned to Papa and said, with a face radiant with joy,
You have brought the girl up well, father-in-law.
Rejected. The ultimatum rejected. This took place at Turin, April 26. The die is cast. War has broken out. End of section 2.
Section 3 of Lay Down Your Arms. Lay Down Your Arms by Bertha von Suttner. Translated by Timothy Holmes. Chapter 2, Part 1. Last hours with the beloved one. Public feeling in the prospect of war. The parting. Employments of the women at home. Anxieties over the news from the seat of war. Ill success of Austria. Friends in trouble. The Patriotic Aid Association. Visit to a friend. Dreadful news. For a week I had been prepared for the catastrophe, and yet its occurrence gave me a bitter blow. I threw myself sobbing on the sofa and hid my face in the cushion when Arnold brought me the news. He sat down by me and began gently to comfort me. My darling, courage, compose yourself. It is not so bad after all. In a short time, we shall return as conquerors. Then we too shall be doubly happy. Do not weep so. It breaks my heart. I am almost sorry that I have engaged to go in any case. But no. Just think, if my comrades are forced to go, with what right could I remain at home? You yourself would feel ashamed of me. No. I must experience the baptism of fire sometime. Until that has happened, I do not feel myself truly a man or a soldier. Only think how delightful if I come back with a third star on my collar, perhaps with the cross on my breast. I rested my head on his shoulder and kept on weeping the more. But I reflected how small such things were. Stars and crosses seemed to be at that moment only empty spangles. Not 10 grand crosses on that dear breast could offer me any recompense for the terrible possibility that a ball might shatter it. Arno kissed me on the forehead, put me softly aside, and stood up. I must go out now, my dear, to my colonel. Have your cry out. When I come back, I hope to find you firm and cheerful. That is what I have need of, and not to be shaken with sad anticipations. At such a decisive moment as this, my own dear little wife surely would do nothing to take the heart out of me or damp my ardor for exploits. Goodbye, my treasure. And he departed. I collected myself. His last words were still ringing in my ears. Yes, plainly my duty now was not merely not to damp, but as far as possible to increase his spirit and his ardor for exploits. That is the only way in which women can exercise our patriotism in which we can take any share in the glory our husbands bring from the battlefields. Battlefields. It is surprising how this word suddenly presented itself to my mind in two radically different meanings. Partly in the accustomed historical signification, so pathetic and so calculated to awake the highest admiration, partly in the loathsomeness of the bloody, brutal syllable fight. Yes, those poor men who were being hurried out had to lie stricken down on the field with their gaping, bleeding wounds, and among them, perhaps, and the loud shriek escaped me as the thought passed through my mind. My maid Betty came running in all in a fright. "For God's sake, my lady, what has happened?" she asked, trembling. I looked at the girl. Her eyes also were red with weeping. I guessed she knew the tidings already, and her lover was a soldier. I felt as if I could press my sister in misfortune to my heart. "It is nothing, my child," I said softly. "Those who go away will surely return." "Ah, my gracious lady, not all," she replied, breaking out anew into tears. My aunt now came in, and Betty withdrew. "I am come, Martha, to speak comfort to you," said the old lady, as she embraced me, "and to preach to you resignation in this trial." "So you know it?" "The whole city knows it, and great joy prevails, for this war is very popular." "Joy, Aunt Mary?" "Oh, yes, among those who see no beloved member of their families ordered out. I could easily understand that you must be sad, and so I hastened here. Your papa will also come directly, but not to comfort, only to congratulate. He is quite beside himself with joy that it is to go on, and looks on it as a noble chance for Arnold to take part in it. And he is right in the main. For a soldier, there is nothing better than a war. And that is the way you must look at it, my dear child. To fulfill the duty of your calling is before everything. What must be? Yes, you are right, aunt. What must be? What is inevitable? What is the will of God? Put in Aunt Mary in corroboration. Must be borne with composure and resignation. Bravo, Martha. It is certain that everything happens as is before determined by a wise and all-merciful providence in his immutable counsels. Everyone's death hour is fixed and written down at the hour of his birth. And for our dear warriors, we will pray so much and so earnestly. I did not stop to debate more closely the contradiction that lay between the two assumptions that a fatal event was at the same time ordained, and also could be turned aside by prayer. I was myself not clear on the point, and had from my whole education a vague impression that in such sacred matters one ought not to embark on reasonings. And indeed, if I had given voice to such scruples before my aunt, it would have grievously shocked her. Nothing could hurt her more than for people to express rational doubt on certain points. Not to argue about it is the conventional commandment in matters mysterious. As etiquette forbids to address questions to a king, so it is a kind of impious breach of etiquette to want to make inquiries or criticize about a dogma. Not to argue about it is also a commandment easily obeyed, and on this occasion I followed it very willingly, and so I did not enter into any contention with my aunt, but on the contrary, clung to the consolation that lay in the resort to prayer. Yes, during the whole time my lord was absent, I determined to beg so earnestly for the protection of heaven that it should turn aside every bullet in the volley from Arnold. Turn them aside. Whither? To the breast of another, for whom, nevertheless, prayers were also being made? And besides, what had been demonstrated to me in my course of physics about the accurately computable and infallible effects of matter and its motion. What, another doubt? Away with it. Yes, aunt, I said aloud, in order to break short these contradictions that kept crossing each other in my mind. Yes, we will pray continually, and God will hear us. Arnold will keep unhurt. You see, dear child, how in heavy times the soul still flies to religion. Perhaps the Almighty sends you this trial in order that you may lay aside your former lukewarmness. This again did not strike me as correct, that the whole misunderstanding between Austria and Sardinia, dating even from the Crimean War, all the negotiations, the dispatch of the ultimatum and its rejection, could have been ordained by God in order to warm up my lukewarm spirit. But to express this doubt would also have been a breach of propriety. As soon as anyone introduces the name of the Almighty, the claims connected with that name give him a kind of spiritual immunity. But with regard to the charge of lukewarmness, it had some foundation. My aunt's religious feeling came from the depths of her heart, while my piety was more external. My father was in this respect quite indifferent, and so was my husband, and so I had had no stimulus from either the one or the other to any particular zeal of belief. I had never had any means either of plunging deeply into ecclesiastical learning, since I had always been able to leave such things unattacked on the not argue about them principle. True, I went every week to Mass and every year to confession, and attended these services with much reverence and devotion, but the whole thing was still more or less an observance of the etiquette becoming to my position. I fulfilled my religious duties with the same correctness as I went through the figures of the lancers at the state ball, and made the state courtesy when the Empress came into the room. Our chaplain at the chateau in Lower Austria and the nuncio in Vienna could have nothing to say against me, yet the charge which my aunt brought against me was perfectly justified. "Yes, my child," she went on, "in prosperity and happiness, people easily forget their home above. But if sickness or fear of death breaks in on us, or still more, on those we love, if we are stricken down or in sorrow," she would have gone on in this style for a long time, but the door burst open and my father rushed in. "Hooray, it's begun now," was his joyful greeting to us. "They wanted a whipping, these puppies, did they? And a whipping they shall have. That they shall." End of section 3. Section 4 of Lay Down Your Arms. Lay Down Your Arms by Bertha von Suttner, translated by Timothy Holmes, Chapter 2, Part 2. It was a time of excitement. The war has broken out. People forget that it is really two masses of men who are rushing to fight each other, and conceive of the event as if it was some exalted overruling third power whose outbreak compels these two masses into the fight. The whole responsibility falls on this power, lying beyond the wills of individuals, and which on its side merely produces the fulfillment of the destined fate of the nations. Such is the dark and awful conception which the majority of mankind have of war, and which was mine too. There was no question of my feeling any revolt against making war in general. What I suffered from was only that my beloved husband had to go out into the danger, and I too stayed behind in anxiety and solitude. I rummaged up all my old impressions from the days of my historical studies in order to strengthen and inspire me with the conviction that it was the highest of human duties which called my dear one away, and that thereby the possibility was offered to him of covering himself with glory and honor. Now, at any rate, I was living in the midst of an epoch of history, and this again was a peculiarly elevating thought. Since from Herodotus and Tacitus down to the historians of modern times, wars have always been represented as the events of most importance and of weightiest consequence, I concluded that at the present time also, a war of this sort would pass with future historians as an event to serve for the title of a chapter. This elevated tone, overpowering in its impressiveness, was that which prevailed everywhere else. Nothing else was spoken of in rooms or streets, nothing else read in the newspapers, nothing else prayed about in the churches. Wherever one went, one found everywhere the same excited faces, the same eager talk about the possibilities of the war. Everything else which engaged the people's interests at other times, the theater, business, art, was now looked on as perfectly insignificant. It seemed to one as if it were not right to think of anything else whilst the opening scene in this great drama of the destiny of the world was being played out, and the different orders to the army with the well-known phrases of the certainty of victory and promise of glory, and the troops marching out with clanging music and waving banners, and the leading articles and public speeches conceived in the most glowing tone of loyalty and patriotism, the eternal appeal to virtue, honor, duty, courage, self-sacrifice, the assurances made on both sides that their nation was known to be the most invincible, most courageous, most certainly destined to a higher extension of power, the best and the noblest, all this spread around an atmosphere of heroism, which filled the whole population with pride and called out in each individual the belief that he was a great citizen in a great state. Such bad qualities, however, as these, lust of conquest, love of fighting, hatred, cruelty, guile, were also certainly to be found and were admitted to be shown in war, but always by the enemy. To him, his being in the wrong was quite clear. Quite apart from the political necessity of the campaign just commenced, apart also from the patriotic advantages which undoubtedly grew out of it, the conquest over one's adversary was a moral work, a discipline carried out by the genius of culture. These Italians, what a foul, false, sensual, light-minded, conceited people! And this Louis Napoleon, what a mixture of ambition and the spirit of intrigue! When his proclamation of war, published on April 29, appeared with its motto, Italy free to the Adriatic Sea, it called out amongst us a storm of indignation. I did allow myself a feeble remark that this was at least an unselfish and noble idea, which must have an inspiriting influence on Italian patriots, but I was soon put to silence. The dogma that Louis Napoleon is a scoundrel was not to be shaken as long as he was the enemy. Everything proceeding from him was ab initio Gaudrelli. Another slight doubt arose in me. In all the battle stories of history, I had found that the sympathy and admiration of the relators were always expressed for the party who wanted to free themselves from a foreign yoke and who fought for freedom. It is true that I was not capable of giving any distinct idea of the meaning of the word yoke or of that of freedom, though so abundantly sung about. But one thing seemed to me perfectly clear, viz., that the shaking off of the yoke and the struggle for freedom lay this time on the side not of Austria, but of Italy. But even for these scruples, timidly conceived as they were, and still more timidly expressed, I was thundered down. For here I was so unlucky as again to trench on a sacred principle, namely that our government, i.e., the government under which one happened to have been born, could never result in a yoke, but only in a blessing, that any who wished to tear themselves loose from us could not be warriors of freedom, but only simple rebels, and that generally and in all circumstances we were always and everywhere wholly in the right. In the early days of May, they were luckily cold and rainy days. Sunny spring weather would have made too painful a contrast the regiment into which Arnold had exchanged march. At 7 in the morning, the preceding night, what a terrible night it was! If the dear one had only been going on a journey of business, free from any danger, the parting would have made me unspeakably sorrowful. Parting is indeed so sad. But to the war, to meet the fiery shower of the enemy's bullets, why could I no longer on that night apprehend at all in that word war its elevated historical signification, but only its terror and threatening of death? Arnold had fallen asleep. He lay there breathing quietly with a cheerful expression on his features. I had lighted a fresh candle and put it behind a screen. I could not be in the dark that night. Of sleep there was no question whatever for me in that, the last night. I felt that I must spend the whole time in gazing at least into the beloved face. I lay on our bed wrapped in a dressing gown, and with my elbow on the pillow and my chin resting on the palm of my hand, looked down on the sleeper and wept silently. How I love you! How I love you, my own one! And you are going away from me. Why is fate so cruel? How shall I live without you? Oh, that you may soon come back to me. Oh, God, my good God, my merciful Father above, let him come back soon. Him and all, let there soon be peace. Why then cannot there be peace always? We were so happy, perhaps too happy, for there cannot be any perfect happiness on earth. Oh, rapture, if he comes home unhurt and then lies at my side as he is doing now, and no parting threatened for the morrow, how quietly you are sleeping, oh, my dear, brave husband. But how shall you sleep there? There is no soft bed for you, hung with silk and lace. There you must lie on the hard, wet earth, perhaps in some ditch, helpless, wounded. And with this thought, I could not help picturing a gaping saber cut on his forehead, with the blood trickling from it, or a bullet wound in his breast, and a hot pang of compassion seized me. How I should have liked to throw my arms round him and kiss him, but I dared not wake him. He wanted this invigorating sleep. Not 6 o'clock yet? Tick, tack, tick, tack. Unpittingly swift and sure time marches on to every mark. This indifferent tick, tack distressed me. The light, too, burned just as indifferently behind its screen as this clock ticked with its silly, motionless cupid. Can it be that all these things have no perception, that it is our last night? My tearful lids fell together, my consciousness gradually went away, and letting my head sink on the pillow, I fell asleep at last myself, but only for a short time. Hardly had I lost my sense in the fog of some formless dream when my heart suddenly contracted painfully, and I awoke with a violent palpitation and the same feeling of fear as when one is awakened by a cry for help or an alarm of fire. Parting, parting, was the alarm cry. When I had started so out of sleep for the 10th or 12th time, it was day, and the candle was flickering out. A knock came at the door. 6 o'clock, Lieutenant, said the orderly, who had been ordered to wake him in good time. Arnold rose up. So now the hour was come. Now was to be spoken this sad, sad word, farewell. It had been settled that I was not to go to the railway with him. The one quarter of an hour more or less together, that was not worth much. And the pain of tearing ourselves asunder at last, that I did not wish to show to strangers. I wanted to be alone in my room when we exchanged the parting kiss, that I might be able to throw myself on the floor and shriek, shriek out loud. Arnold put on his clothes quickly. As he was doing so, he made me all kinds of comforting speeches. Courage, Martha. In 2 months, at the most, the affair will be over, and I shall be back again at cuckoo time. Only 1 in 1,000 bullets hits, and that one must not hit me. Others before me have come back from the wars. Look at your papa. It must happen some time or other. You did not marry an officer of hussars with the notion that his business was to grow hyacinths. I will write to you as often as possible, and tell you how pleasantly and livelily the whole campaign is going on. If anything bad were destined for me, I could not feel so cheerful. I am going only to win an order, nothing else. Take great care here of yourself and our Ruru, and if I get promotion, he shall have another step too. Kiss him for me. I will not repeat the parting of last night. The time will come when it will be a treat for him to have his father tell him how in the year 59 he was present at the great victory over Italy. I listened to him greedily. This confident chatter did me good. He was going away all pleased and in good spirits, and so my suffering must be egotistic and therefore wrong. This thought ought to give me strength to conquer it. Another knock at the door. Time now, Lieutenant. I am quite ready. Coming directly. He spread out his arms. Now then, Martha, my wife. My love. I lay at once on his breast. I could not speak a word. The word farewell would not pass my lips. I felt that in saying that word I should give way, and I did not dare to poison the peace, the cheerfulness of his departure. I reserved the outbreak of my pain as a kind of reward for my solitude. But now he spoke the heartbreaking word. Goodbye, my all. Goodbye. And pressed his lips closely to mine. We could not tear ourselves out of this embrace, as though it were our last. Then, on a sudden, I felt how his lips were trembling, how convulsively his bosom heaved, and then, releasing me, he covered his face and sobbed aloud. That was too much for me. I thought I was going out of my mind. Arno! Arno! I cried out, throwing my arms round him. Stay! Stay! I knew I was asking what was impossible. Still, I cried out persistently. Stay! Stay! Lieutenant, we heard from outside. It is now quite time. One more kiss, the last of all, and he rushed out. End of section 4. Section 5 of Lay Down Your Arms. Lay Down Your Arms by Bertha von Suttner. Translated by Timothy Holmes. Chapter 2, Part 3. To tear Sharpie, to read the news in the papers, to stick pins with flags into our maps in order to follow the movements of the two armies, and try to solve the chess problems that followed from them in the sense that Austria attacks and gives mate at the fourth move, to pray continually in the churches for the protection of our loved ones and the victory of our country's arms, to talk of nothing except the news that came in from the theater of war. Such was what filled up my existence now, and that of my relatives and acquaintance. Life, with all its other interests, appeared suspended, as it were during the term of the campaign. Everything except the question, how and when will this war end, was bereft of importance, nay, almost of reality. One ate, drank, read, saw after one's affairs, but all this had no real concern for us. One thing only concerned us thoroughly, the telegrams from Italy. My chief gleams of light were, of course, the news that I received from Arno himself. They were in a curt style. Letter writing had never been his strong point, but they brought me the most cheering testimony that he was still alive and unwounded. These letters and dispatches could not indeed arrive with much regularity, for the communications were often interrupted, or when an action was impending, the field post was suspended. If a few days had passed thus, without my hearing from Arno, and a list of killed and wounded was published, with what terror did I not read over the names? It is as great a strain as for the holder of a lottery ticket to look through the winning numbers in the list of a drawing. But in the opposite sense, what one seeks in this case, well knowing, thank God, that the chance is against one, is the chief prize in misery. The first time that I read the names of the slain, and I had been 4 days without news, and saw that the name of Arno Dotsky was not among them, I folded my hands and cried aloud, "My God, I thank thee!" But the words were hardly out of my mouth when it seemed to me like a shrill discord. I took the paper in my hand again and looked at the list of names once more. So I thank God because Adolf Schmidt and Karl Müller and many others were slain, but not Arno Dotsky. Then the same thanksgiving would have been appropriate if it had risen to heaven from the hearts of those who trembled for Schmidt and Müller, if they had read Dotsky instead of those names. And why should my thanks in particular be more pleasing to heaven than theirs? Yes, this was the shrill discord of my ejaculation, the presumption and the self-seeking which lay in it, in believing that Arno had been spared in love for me, and thanking God that not I but Schmidt's mother and Müller's affianced and 50 others had to burst out in tears over that list. On the same day, I received from Arno another letter. Yesterday we had another stout fight, unfortunately a defeat. But comfort yourself, my beloved Martha. The next battle will bring us victory. It was my first great affair. I was standing in the midst of a heavy storm of bullets, a peculiar feeling. I will tell you by word of mouth, but it is frightful. The poor fellows whom one sees falling around one, and must leave there in spite of their sad cries, C'est la guerre. Hope to see you soon again, my dear. If we can once dictate terms of peace at Turin, you shall travel after to meet me. Aunt Mary will be kind enough to take care of our little corporal. But if the receipt of letters like these constituted the sunshine of my life, its darkest shadows were my nights. If I woke out of some dream of blessed forgetfulness, and the horrible reality with its horrible possibilities came before my consciousness, I was seized with an almost intolerable pain and could not sleep again for hours. I could not get rid of the idea that Arnold was perhaps at that moment lying in the ditch groaning and dying, thirsting after a drop of water and calling longingly for me. The only way that I could gradually compose myself was by bringing with all my force the scene of his return before my imagination. This was, at any rate, as probable, nay, perhaps more probable, than his lonely death, and so I pictured him to myself as bursting into the room, and how I should fling myself on his bosom, and how I should then lead him to Ruru's cradle, and how happy and how joyful we might then once more be. My father was much cast down. One bad news came upon another. First Montebello, then Magenta. And not he alone, but all Vienna was cast down. We had at the beginning so confidently hoped that uninterrupted messages of victory would give occasion for mounting flags on our houses and singing Te Deums. But instead of this, the flags were waving and the priests singing at Turin. There the word now was, Lord God, we praise thee, that thou hast helped us to strike down the wicked Tedeschi. Do not you think, Papa, I began, that if another defeat was to happen to us, peace would then be made? In that case, I should wish that, are you not ashamed to say anything of the kind? I had rather it should be a 30 years war, so that our arms should conquer at last, and we dictate the terms of peace. What do men go to war for? I suppose not to get out of it again as quickly as possible. If so, they might as well remain at home. And that would be by far the best, sighed I. What a cowardly lot you women folk are, even you, you who have been so well grounded in the principles of love of country and feelings of honor, are yet quite out of heart already, and prize your personal quiet more than the welfare and fame of your country. Ah, if I did not love my Arnold so dearly, love of your husband, love of your family, all that is very good, but it ought only to occupy the second place. Ought it? End of section 5. Section 6 of Lay Down Your Arms. Lay Down Your Arms by Bertha von Suttner. Translated by Timothy Holmes. Chapter 2, Part 4. The list of killed had already brought the names of several officers whom I had known personally. Among others, that of the son, her only one, of an old lady for whom I had conceived a great feeling of respect. That day I determined to visit the poor lady. It was, for me, a painful, heavy journey. I could certainly give her no consolation, could only weep with her, but it was the duty of affection, and so I set out. When I got to Frau V. Ullmann's dwelling, I long hesitated before pulling the bell. The last time I had been there was to a cheerful little dance. The dear old mistress of the house was herself then full of joy. Martha, she said to me in the course of the evening, we are the two most enviable women in Vienna. You have the handsomest of husbands, and I the most excellent of sons. And today I still indeed had my husband, but who knows? The shells and grape shot were flying there still without ceasing. The minute just passed might have made me a widow, and I began to weep before the door. That was the proper temper for so mournful a visit. I rang. No one came. I rang a second time. Again, no answer. Then someone put his head out of the door of one of the other floors. It is no good ringing, miss. The dwelling is empty. What? Has Frau V. Ullmann gone? She was taken to a lunatic asylum 3 days since, and the head disappeared again as the door shut. I remained for a minute or two motionless, rooted to the spot, and the scenes, which must have been going on here, passed before my eyes. To what a height must the poor lady's sufferings have risen before her agony broke out in madness? And there is my father, wishing that the war might last 30 years for the welfare of the country. How many more such mothers in the country would have been driven to desperation? I went down the stairs, shaken to my inmost depth. I determined that I would pay another visit to a young lady, a friend of mine, whose husband, like mine, was at the theater of war. My way led me through the Herrengasse, past the building called the Landhouse, where the Patriotic Aid Association had established its offices. At that time, there was not as yet any convention of Geneva, any Red Cross, and this aid association had been formed as a forerunner of these humane institutions, its task being to receive alms of all kinds in money, linen, charpie, bandages, etc., for the poor wounded and forward them to the seat of war. The gifts came flowing in abundantly from all sides. It was necessary to have whole shops to receive them, and scarcely were the different articles packed up and sent off when new ones were piled up again in their place. I went in. I was in distress till I could hand over to the committee all that I had in my purse. Perhaps that might bring health and deliverance to some suffering soldier and save his mother from madness. I knew the president. Is Prince C here? I asked the porter. Not just now, but the vice president, Baron S, is upstairs. He showed me the way to the room where the alms and money were paid. I had to pass through several halls where on long tables were the packets lying in rows. Parcels of linen, cigars, tobacco, and especially mountains of charpie. It made me shudder. How many wounds must be bleeding there to be covered with all this torn linen? And there was my father, I thought again, wishing that for the country's good the war might last another 30 years. How many of the country's sons must, in that case, sink under their wounds? Baron S. received my contribution with thanks and gave me the most ready information about the working of the association in reply to my numerous questions. It was joyful and comforting to hear how much good was thus done. Just at the time came the postman with some letters that had newly arrived and announced that 2 barrels of offerings had to be delivered from the country. I placed myself on a sofa, which was in the lower part of the room, to watch the reception of the packets. They were, however, delivered in another room. A very old gentleman now came in, who by his bearing was evidently an old soldier. "Permit me, Baron," he said as he drew out his purse and sat down on a stool by the table. "Permit me to add my little mite, too, to your noble work," and he gave him a note for 100 florins. "I look on all this organization of yours as really angelic. You see, I am an old soldier myself," and he gave his name as general, "and I can judge what an enormous blessing it is to the poor fellows who are fighting out there. I served in the campaigns of the years 9 and 13. At that time, there was no Patriotic Aid Association. At that time, no one sent chests of bandages and charpie after the wounded. How many must then have bled to death in misery when the resources of the army surgeons were exhausted? Who might have been saved by sending such things as I see here? Ah, yours is a blessed work. You good noble men, you do not know, no, you do not know how much good you are doing there." And 2 great tears fell on the old man's white mustache. A noise of steps and voices arose outside. Both leaves of the entrance door were thrown open and a guardsman announced, "Her Majesty the Empress." The vice president hurried out to the gate to receive his exalted visitor, as beseemed at the foot of the stairs, but she had already got into the anteroom. I, from my concealed position, looked with admiration on the young sovereign, who in coming walking dress appeared to me almost lovelier than in her state robes at the court ball. "I am come," she said to Baron S., "because I received a letter today from the Emperor from the seat of war, in which he writes to tell me how useful and acceptable the gifts of the Patriotic Aid Association have proved, and so I wish to look into the matter myself and put the committee in receipt of the Emperor's acknowledgment." On this she made them give her information about all the details of the working of the association, and examined as she went along the various objects from their stores. "Just look, Countess," she said to the mistress of the robes, who was with her, taking an article of underclothing in her hand. How good this linen is, and how beautifully sewn. Then she begged the vice president to conduct her into another of the rooms, and left the hall by his side. She spoke to him with visible contentment, and I heard her say besides, "It is a fine patriotic undertaking, and to the poor soldiers." I could not catch any more. Poor soldiers. The word kept coming back to me for a long time. She had pronounced it with so much pity. Yes, poor, indeed, and the more one could do to send them help and comfort, the better. But it ran through my head. If they had not sent these poor people into this misery at all, would not that have been much better? I tried to scare away the thought. It must be so. It must be so. There is no other excuse for the cruelty of making war except what is contained in the little word must. Now I went on my way again. The friend whom I was going to visit lived quite close to the land house on the coal mart. As I walked along, I went into a book and print shop to buy myself a new map of Upper Italy. Ours had become quite riddled with sticking in the little flags on pens. Besides me, there were many other customers in the place. All were asking for maps, diagrams, and so forth. Now came my turn. "Do you want the theater of war too, please?" asked the bookseller. "You have guessed it. No difficulty in that. There is hardly anything else bought." He went to get what I wanted, and while he wrapped up the roll in paper for me, he said to a gentleman standing next to me, "You see, Professor, just now things go badly for those who write or publish books on belles lettres or science. No one asks for such things. As long as the war lasts, no interest is taken by anyone in intellectual matters. It is a bad time for writers and booksellers." "And a bad time for the nation," replied the professor, "since a loss of interest in such things is naturally followed by its decline in the intellectual scale." "And there is my father wishing," thought I for the third time, "that for the good of the country, a 30 years' war." I now took part audibly in the conversation. "So your business is doing badly?" "Mine only?" "No, almost all, your ladyship," answered the bookseller. "Except the providers for the army, there are no tradesmen to whom the war has not brought untold loss. Everything is at a standstill. Work in the factories, work in the fields. Men without number are without places and without bread. Our paper is falling, the exchange rising. All desire for enterprise is decaying. Many firms must go bankrupt. In short, it is a misery. And there is my father wishing," I repeated in silence as I left the shop. End of section 6. Section 7 of Lay Down Your Arms. Lay Down Your Arms by Bertha von Suttner. Translated by Timothy Holmes. Chapter 2, Part 5. My friend was at home. Countess Lori Griesbach was in more than one respect the sharer of my lot. A general's daughter like me, married for only a short time to an officer like me, and, like me, a grass widow. In one thing, she went beyond me. She had not only a husband, but two brothers also at the war. But Lori was not of an apprehensive nature. She was fully persuaded that her dear ones were under the peculiar protection of a saint whom she highly venerated, and she counted confidently on their return. She received me with open arms. "Ah, God bless you, Martha. It is indeed good of you to come and see me. But how pale and worn you are looking. You have not had any bad news from the seat of war?" "No, thank God. But the whole thing is so sad." "Ah, yes. You mean the defeat? But you must not think too much of that. The next news may announce a victory. Whether we conquer or are conquered, war is in itself dreadful altogether." "Would it not be better if there could be nothing of the kind?" "Then what would be the good of soldiers?" "What indeed?" I assented. "Then there would be none." "What nonsense you are talking. That would be a nice state of things. Nothing but civilians. It makes me shudder. Happily, that is impossible." "Impossible?" "Yes, you must be right. I will believe so. Or else I could not conceive that it would not long since have happened. What happened? The abolition of war. But no, I might as well talk of the abolition of earthquakes. I don't know what you mean. As far as I am concerned, I am glad this war has broken out, because I hope that my Louis will distinguish himself. And for my brothers, too, it is a good thing. Promotion has been going on so slowly. Now they have at least a chance. Have you had any news lately? I interrupted. Are your relatives all well? No, not for a pretty long time now. But, you know, the postal service is often interrupted. And when people are tired out with a hot march or a battle, they have not much taste for writing. I am quite easy. Both Louis and my brothers were blessed amulets. Mama hung them on herself. What would you expect to happen, Lori, in a war in which every man in both armies wore an amulet? If the bullets were flying on both sides, would they retire back into the clouds and do no harm? I do not understand you. You are so lukewarm in faith. Your Aunt Mary often laments about it to me. Why do you not answer my question? Because it involves a sneer at a thing which to me is sacred. Sneer, oh no, only a reasonable reflection. But you must know that it is a sin to entrust your own reason with the power of judging in things which are above us. Well, I have done, Lori. You may be right. Reflection and research are of no use. For some time, all kinds of doubts have risen within me about my most ancient convictions, and I find only pain from them. If I were to lose the conviction that it was a necessity and a good thing to begin this war, I should never be able to forgive him who... You mean Louis Napoleon? What an intriguer he is. Whether he or another, I should like to remain in the undisturbed belief that there are no men at all who have caused the war, but that it broke out of itself, broke out like a nervous fever, like the eruption of Vesuvius. How excited you get, my love, but let us speak reasonably, so listen to me. In a short time, the war will be over, and our husbands will come back captains. I will then try to get mine to obtain 4 or 6 weeks' leave and take a trip with me to a watering place. It will do him good after all the fatigues he will have undergone, and me also after the heat and the ennui and the anxiety I have undergone. For you must not think that I have no fear at all. It may be God's will after all that one of my dear ones should meet with a soldier's death, and even though it is a noble, enviable death on the field of honor for emperor and fatherland. Why, you are speaking just like one of the proclamations to the army. Yet it would be frightful, poor mama, if anything was to happen to Gustav or Karl. Don't let us talk about it. And so, to refresh us after all our terror, it would be good to have a gay season at a watering place. I should prefer Carlsbad, and I went there when I was a girl and amused myself amazingly. I too went to Marienbad. It was there I made Arnold's acquaintance. But why are we sitting here idle like this? Have you no linen at hand that we could tear into chapi? I was at the Patriotic Aid Association today, and there came in, who do you think? Here I was interrupted. A footman brought in a letter. From Gustav, cried Lori joyfully as she broke the seal. When she had read 2 lines, she gave a shriek. The paper fell out of her hand, and she threw herself on my neck. Lori, my poor dear, what is it? I cried, deeply moved. Your husband? Oh, God, she groaned. Read for yourself. I took the letter from the floor and began to read. I can reproduce the phraseology exactly, because afterwards I begged the letter from Lori to copy it into my diary. Read out loud, she said. I was not able to read it through. I did as she wished. Dear sister, yesterday we had a hot combat. There must be a long list of casualties. In order that you, and in order that our poor mother, may not hear in that way of the misfortune, that you may be able to prepare her for it gradually, tell her he is severely wounded. I write at once, my dear, to tell you that our brave brother Carl is of the number of the warriors who have died for their country. I interrupted my reading to embrace my friend. I had got so far, she said gently. With tearful voice, I read on. Your husband is untouched, and so am I. would that the enemy's bullet had hit me instead. I envy Carl, his hero's death. He fell at the beginning of the battle and did not know that this one again was lost. It is really too bitter. I saw him fall, for we were riding near each other. I jumped down at once to pick him up. Only one look, and he was dead. The bullet must have passed through his lungs or heart. It was a quick, painless death. How many others had to suffer for hours and to lie helpless on the field in the heat of the battle till death released them? It was a murderous day. More than 1,000 corpses, friend and enemy, covered the battlefield. I recognized among the dead the faces of so many dear friends, and amongst others, there is poor. Here I had to turn the page. Poor Arnold Dotsky. I fell unconscious on the floor. End of chapter 2.
Section 8 of Lay Down Your Arms. Lay Down Your Arms by Bertha von Suttner. Translated by Timothy Holmes. Chapter 3, Part 1. Chapter 3. First years of widowhood, solitude, study, enlarged views. I return into society, renewed enjoyment of life, thoughts of second marriage. I chaperone my younger sisters. I'm introduced to Baron Tilling. He brings me an account of the manner of Arno's death. Now, Martha, it is all over. Solferino was decisive. We are beaten. My father came hastily one morning onto the terrace with these words, where I was sitting under the shadow of a clump of lime trees. I had gone back home to the house of my girlhood with my little Ruru. A week after the great battle which had struck me down, my family moved to Grumitz, our country house in Lower Austria, and I with them. I should have been in despair alone. Now all were again around me, just as before my marriage, Papa, Aunt Mary, my little brother, and my two growing sisters. All of them did what they possibly could to mitigate my grief and treated me with a certain consideration which did me good. Evidently they found in my sad fate a sort of consecration, something which raised me above those around me, even a kind of merit. Next to the blood which soldiers pour out on the altar of their country, the tears which the bereaved mothers, wives, and sweethearts of the soldiers pour on the same altar become a libation hardly less sacred. And thus it was a slight feeling of pride, a consciousness that to have lost a beloved husband on the field of honour conferred a kind of military merit which had helped me most to bear my pain. And I was far from being the only one. How many women in the whole of the country were there mourning over their loved ones sleeping in Italian earth? At that time, no further particulars were known to me of Arno's end. He had been found dead, recognised, and buried. That was all I knew. His last thought, doubtless, had flown towards me and our little darling, and his consolation in the last moment must have been, I have done my duty, and more than my duty. We are beaten, repeated my father gloomily, as he sat down by me on the garden seat. So those who have been sacrificed were sacrificed in vain, I sighed. Those who have been sacrificed are to be envied, for they know nothing of the shame which has befallen us. But we will soon pick up again for all that, even if, at present, peace, as they say, must be concluded. Ah, God grant it, I interrupted. Too late indeed for my poor Arno, but still thousands of others will be spared. You are always thinking of yourself and of individuals, but in this matter it is Austria which is in question. Well, but does not she consist entirely of individuals? My dear, a kingdom, a state, lives a longer and more important life than individuals do. They disappear generation after generation, while the state expands still farther, grows into glory, greatness, and power, or sinks and crumbles up and disappears, if it allows itself to be overcome by other kingdoms. Therefore, the most important and the highest aim for which any individual has to struggle, and for which he ought to be glad to die, is the existence, the greatness, and the well-being of the kingdom. I impressed these words on my mind in order to put them down the same day in the red volume. They seemed to me to express so clearly and strongly the feeling which I had derived in my student days from the books of history, a feeling which, in these last times, after Arne's departure, had been driven out of my mind by fear and pity. I wanted to cleave to it again as close as possible, in order to find consolation and support in the idea that my darling had fallen in a great cause, and that my misfortune itself was only one element in this great cause. Aunt Mary had, on the other hand, a different source of consolation ready. "Do not weep, dear child," she used to say when I was sunk in profound grief. "Do not be so selfish as to bewail him who is now so happy. He is among the blessed, and is looking down on you with blessing. After a few quickly passing years on earth, you will find him again in the fullness of his glory. For those who have fallen on the field of battle, heaven reserves its fairest dwellings. Happy those who were called away just at the moment when they were fulfilling a holy duty. The dying soldier stands next in merit to the dying martyr. Then I am to be glad that... not to be glad, that would be asking too much, but to bear your lot with humble resignation. It is a probation that heaven sends you, and from which you should emerge purified and strengthened in faith. So, in order that I might be tried and purified, Arno had to... No, not on that account, but who dare seek to sound the hidden ways of Providence? Not I, at least. Although such objections always would rise in me against Aunt Mary's consolations, yet in the depths of my heart I readily fell in with the mystical assumption that my glorified one was now enjoying in heaven the reward of his death of sacrifice, and that his memory on earth was adorned with the eternal glory of sainthood. How exalting, though painful at the same time, was the effect on me of the great mourning celebration at which I was present in the Cathedral of St. Stephen's on the day of our departure. It was the De Profundis for our warriors who had fallen on foreign soil and were buried there. In the centre of the church, a high catafalque had been erected, surrounded by 100 lighted candles and decorated with military emblems, flags, and arms. From the choir came down the moving strains of the Requiem, and those present, chiefly women in mourning, were almost all weeping aloud. And each one was weeping, not only for him whom she had lost, but for the rest who had met with the same death, for all of them together, all the poor, brave brothers-in-arms who had given their young lives for us all, that is, for the country, the honour of the nation, and the living soldiers who attended this ceremony, all the generals and officers who had remained behind in Vienna, were there, and several companies of soldiers filled the background. All were waiting and ready to follow their fallen comrades without delay, without murmur, without fear. Yes, with the clouds of incense, with the pealing bells, and the voice of the organ, with the tears poured out in the common woe, there must surely have risen a well-pleasing sacrifice to heaven, and the Lord of Armies must shower his blessing down on those to whom this catafalque was erected. So I thought at that time. At least, these were the words with which the Red Book describes this morning ceremony. About 14 days later than the news of the defeat of Solferino came the news of the signing of the preliminaries of peace at Villafranca. My father took all the pains possible to explain to me that for political reasons it was a matter of pressing necessity to conclude this peace, on which I assured him that it seemed to me joyful news anyhow that this fighting and dying should come to an end, that my good papa would not be hindered from setting forth at length all his exculpatory statements. You must not think that we are afraid. Even if it has a look as if we had made concessions, yet we forgo nothing of our dignity, and know perfectly what we are about. If it concerned ourselves only, we should never have given up the game on account of this little check at Solferino. Oh no, far from it. We should only have had to send down another corps d'armée, and the enemy would have been obliged to evacuate Milan again in quick time. But you know, Martha, that other things are concerned, general interests and principles. We renounce the further prosecution of the war for this reason, in order to secure the other principalities in Italy which are menaced, those that the captain of the Sardinian robbers, with his French hangman ally, would be glad to fall upon also. They want to advance against Modena, Tuscany, whereas you know dynasties are in power related to our own imperial family, nay, even against Rome, against the Pope, the Vandals. If we do provisionally give up Lombardy, yet we keep Venetia all the time, and are able to assure the South Italian states and the Holy See of our support. So you perceive that it is merely for political reasons, and in the interest of the balance of power in Europe. Oh yes, Father, I broke in. I perceive it. But oh, that these reasons had prevailed before Magenta, I continued, sighing bitterly. Then, to change the subject, I pointed to a parcel of books that had come in that day from Vienna. See here, the bookseller has sent us several things on approval. Amongst them, there is the work of an English natural philosopher, one Darwin, The Origin of Species, and he calls our attention to it as being of special interest and likely to be of epoch-making importance. My worthy friend must excuse me. Who, in such a momentous time as this, could take an interest in these tomfooleries? What could a book about the kinds of beasts and plants contain of epoch-making importance for us men? The confederation of the Italian states, the hegemony of Austria and the German Bund, these are matters of far-stretching influence. These will long keep their place in history, when no living man shall any longer know anything about that English book there. Mark my words. I did mark them. End of section 8. Section 9 of Lay Down Your Arms. Lay Down Your Arms by Bertha von Suttner. Translated by Timothy Holmes. Chapter 3, Part 2. 4 years later, my two sisters, now 17 and 18 years old, were to be presented at court. On this occasion, I determined that I would also again go into society. The time which had elapsed had done its work and gradually mitigated my pain. Despair changed into mourning, mourning into sorrow, sorrow into indifference, and even this, at last, into renewed pleasure in life. I woke one fine morning to the conviction that I really was in an enviable condition and one that promised happiness. 23 years old, beautiful, rich, high-born, free, the mother of a darling child, a member of an affectionate family. Was not all this enough to make my life pleasant? The short year of my married life lay behind me like a dream. No doubt I had been desperately in love with my handsome hussar. No doubt my loving husband had made me very happy. No doubt the parting had caused me grievous pain and his loss wild agony. But that was all over. Over. My love had assuredly never grown so closely into the whole existence of my soul that I could never have survived its uprooting, never have lost the pain of it. Our life together had been too short for that. We had adored each other like a pair of ardent lovers, but to have entered into each other, heart to heart, soul to soul, to be fast bound to each other in mutual reverence and friendship, to have shared for long years our joys and our sorrows, this, which is the lot of some married people, had not been given to us two. Even I was assuredly not his highest object, not something indispensable, otherwise he could not so cheerfully and with no compulsion of duty, for his own regiment was never ordered out, have left me. Besides, in these 4 years I had gradually become another creature. My spiritual horizon had enlarged in many respects. I had come into possession of acquirements and views of which I had no notion when I married, and of which Arno also, as I could now perceive, had no idea either. And so, if he could have risen again, he would have stood in the position of a stranger towards many parts of my present spiritual life. How had this change come about with me? This is how it happened. 1 year of my widowhood had passed. The first phase, despair, had given place to mourning, but it was very deep mourning, and my heart was bleeding. Of any renewal of the intercourse of society, I would not hear. I thought that from this time my life must be occupied only with the education of my son, Rudolph. I call the child no longer Ruru or Corporal. The baby jokes of the pair of married lovers were over. The little one turned into my son Rudolph, the sacred centre of all my effort, hope, and love. In order to be one day a good teacher for him, or rather, in order to follow his studies and be able to become his intellectual companion, I wanted to acquire myself all the knowledge that I could. And with this view, reading was the only amusement I allowed myself. And so, I plunged anew into the treasures of the library of our chateau. I was especially impelled to take up again the study which was my peculiar favourite, history. Latterly, when the war had demanded such heavy sacrifices from my contemporaries and myself, my former enthusiasm had become much cooled, and I now wished to light it up again by appropriate reading. And, in fact, it brought me sometimes a kind of consolation. If I had been reading a few pages of accounts of battles with the praises of the heroes which are the natural continuation of those accounts, to think that the death of my poor husband and my own widowed grief were comprised as items in a similar grand historical process. I say sometimes, not always. I could not get myself back entirely and absolutely into the feelings of my girlhood when I wanted to rival the Maid of Orleans. Much, very much, in the overwrought tirades of glory which accompanied the accounts of the battles, sounded to me false and hollow, if at the same time.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.